Hello, art family, and thank you to the new subscribers. Also, a quick special thanks to those who made it to the live painting session I did yesterday. I hope to do more of those. It was really a lot of fun, and the chat was great. So for this video, I decided to do some gouache this time because we've been doing watercolor for a lot of these monthly demos. And I am starting off by just getting rid of the white of the paper. And I'm using some warm and some cools, but most of those colors don't specifically matter because I'm going to come right on top of that with some thicker, more opaque paint. My method for applying gouache is to sort of stain the page with some very wet gouache with about 90% water. And I usually try to shift it warm to cool, and I take that as my first opportunity to try to draw the image. I can kind of feel around the space in 2D for where things line up or meet up before I get into trying to draw the contour lines. From there, I like to try to draw some of the contour lines, trying to think mostly about the shapes that I'm seeing. Start to figure out the sort of puzzle pieces that I need to click together to reveal the image. Then I start thinking about value and the color temperature, and I can start placing in shapes. And my hope is, in this case I'm using a 2-inch flat. So if I use this flat brush and place these sort of 2-inch pixels, these thick kind of pixels next to one another, then in context, when one stands back from the image, it will read clearly. I'm trying to use a lot of bright saturated yellow in some parts of the leaves because there are the thinner parts of the leaves that are getting really illuminated. Off to the left of this, there's an open window with direct sunlight coming through it. To the right, there are some other open windows, so we have both a warm light that's passing across our object, and then a cool ambient light where the north-facing window is allowing some of that cool atmospheric light to enter the room and kind of bounce all around. So we're going to have some areas that face the warm light, which will be enriched with that kind of warm light, and the higher bits of contrast because that light is much stronger. And then the other areas facing away will be more cool. I want to make sure that I'm still using a lot of saturation though, even in the shadows on the plant, which is something I need to fix in a moment on the leaf to the left because I ended up using a little too much blue. If you use too much cools in something like a leaf where light gets trapped inside the object, you can make it look kind of plastic and not real. So I want to make sure I'm giving a luminescent sense to this plant to make sure I'm selling the difference in material between the foliage and, say, the pot or the wooden stool it's sitting on. In this case, I'm working a little bit larger than I usually like to for gouache. This was kind of an experiment. I usually buy my favorite surface to work on is crescent illustration board. It's thick so it doesn't potato chip and curl on you, and it handles the gouache really well. It sits really nicely on the surface. It comes in 16 by 20 sheets. You could probably get bigger if you wanted, but it comes in 16 by 20 and I cut them down into 8 by 10s or sometimes 5 by 7s. And this time I had cut it in half to then cut some more smaller pieces, and I decided to try to go for one larger image, larger than I usually do, which is why I'm using a 2-inch flat for part of it. And this is a 3/4-inch flat, I think, or it might be a 1/2-inch flat. Whether I'm working larger or smaller, the painting method and approach is always the same. It just depends on the size of the brush. I do the same mentality and process for painting a larger image or sketch. I just use a bigger brush. In this case, I'm mostly using a 2-inch flat. What I'm doing is I'm closing an eye and squinting at the reference, and I'm trying to look for just the big shapes, these big kind of puzzle pieces. I'm keeping in mind this light influence that you can see, for example, on the pot the plant's sitting in, given that it's warmer on one side and cooler on the other side. Because, again, we have that warm light coming in, raking in across the scene from the left, and then off to the right is all just ambient cool light from the north-facing window. But I'm trying to piece these puzzle pieces together, first thinking about these big shapes, Now I'm thinking about the negative shapes that are made by the kind of gradient gray of the back wall behind the plant in the corner. There's a soft gradient, it goes a little lighter into darker in the corner. Overall, it goes from lighter to darker down into the bottom part of the image. And in the upper right area, the light from the window to the left is hitting that wall, so it illuminates that wall off to the right where you can't really see outside of the reference photo. But most of what I'm doing is closing an eye and squinting at that and thinking about those big shapes, you know, whether it's like a rectangle here or a triangle shape here or there. I'm trying to think about those negative shapes and how I can use those negative shapes to clean up and correct the drawing of the shapes in the foreground. And also to chisel back into them. For example, given this is a Monstera plant, it has all these little holes in the leaves, so I can use the negative shape of the background mix to cut back into that shape and create those sort of separations. One of my favorite things to paint is glass objects like this little cutting jar we have. We have this little bottle. We have a bunch of them around the house that have cuttings in them. And I love painting them. And my main approach is to just ignore all the bright highlights on the object and focus only on the sort of shapes that I see. So close an eye and squint at it. Ignore the bright highlights and look for those odd little kind of warped shapes that you see. So you'll see sort of what it is the refracted light bending the objects behind it or below it. So you'll see a little bit of the kind of curved shape from the stool, the pot itself, and some value there. There's a darkness there on the bottom part of the pot, the occlusion where the pot meets the wooden stool. So I see that sort of shape. I place those shapes together, trying to approximate the size to fit, you know, where it lines up in two-dimensional space with either other objects or the objects it's sitting in front of. And once all that's done, the most satisfying part of it is to then come back with some white highlights and place them on top of those shapes. And it's really fun to see how just a couple little touches of highlights on top of that mass of shapes really goes a long way in the way of selling the three-dimensionality of it and the glossiness of it. So now that I have those big shapes in, I can start to fine-tune and begin to allow myself to use a smaller brush. This is a size 8 round brush, and I can start to do details and accents around the painting. One thing I'm always looking for is if the value has shifted, because value is always relative. It changes as you put other values down. So one thing I needed to fix was, for example, the leaf on the left, the shadow side is darker than the wall, and the light side is lighter than the wall. So there's this light, dark that happens before you get into the kind of really big leaf in the top. So I had to correct that and also bring some more saturation to that green to give that sense of foliage, that light is getting trapped in the surface. Now that we're moving into the last stages of the sketch, I can start to look for all the little tiny highlights and places of light, make some fine-tuned adjustments, and at about 90%, I like to take the tape off because then you get a better read on the value. It reads a little bit more clear having that stark contrast of the white of the paper on the clean margin. It also gives you an idea of what it's going to look like when it's finished, which it helps to sort of step back from. Sometimes it's best to even literally step back from your sketch and come back to it. Well, that's going to be it for this sketch of a Monstera plant. I hope you got a lot out of this, and I will see you in the next video. In the meantime, happy sketching.